Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Well, this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and we will be glad in it. And we're going to continue to rejoice in the reality that our God reigns and he forever rules. We want to welcome you to this third Sunday in the month of April 2020. And we want to welcome you to this segment of praise, prayer, and preaching. Yes, the world is still going through this global pandemic. However, the church is still moving forward with the word and with the will of our God. And so we want to welcome those who are tuning in through our Facebook Live and those who are tuning in through our telephone conference, our phone conference. And we're so grateful and we're so thankful that God has allowed us to be in the land of the living one more time. Join me for our scripture reading found in Psalm 34. Psalm 34. Verses 1 through 8, and it reads, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Psalm 34, the word of the Lord. Let us bow for a word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, you are eternal, you are everlasting, and Lord, you have been our God and you've been our dwelling place from one generation to the next generation. You are the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. You are the God who sits high and who looks low, who's so mindful and who's so concerned about us, Lord, that you continue to provide for us in so many different areas, meeting so many of our different needs spiritually, physically, financially, emotionally. Lord, we lift up your name today, for your name is worthy to be praised, Lord, from the rising of the sun till the going down of the same. Your name alone is worthy to be praised. And we've come today, Lord, to lift up your name. We've come today to exalt your name. We've come today, Lord, to extol your name, for you are worthy to be praised. Your word tells us, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. And Father, we realize that even our best praise, even our 10,000 of tongues can not even be enough, Lord, for what you really deserve. But we thank you, however, that you've allowed us another day's journey. You've allowed us another privilege to be in the land of the living, whereby we can experience your grace and your goodness, and we can experience, Lord, your blessings. We can experience your reign and your rule, your Lord, your righteousness, your justice, your peace, your joy. Father, we've come today, Lord, before your throne of grace, realizing, God, that if it had not been for the Lord on our side, where would we be? We've come, Lord, to declare like the psalmist declared, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. Lord, we've come to express the confidence of a psalmist when he said that I sought the Lord and he heard me. We've come, Lord, to let it be known that you are good and you're always good. And Lord, we have tasted you and we've discovered for ourselves Lord, that no one can compare to you, and nothing can compare to you. You are preeminent in all of your ways. You alone are worthy. You alone are trustworthy. You are the self-existing God. You are the maker and creator of heaven and earth. And you know us by our names. You even know the number of hairs on our head. You know our lying down and our rising up. You know our strengths and our weaknesses, our ups and our downs. And Lord, you've made us. We are your people and the sheep of your pasture. And we just want to praise you for who you are. You're worthy, oh God, to be praised. We want to thank you now for all of the provisions that you have manifested in our lives up to this present moment. We want to thank you, Lord, for food and shelter and clothing. We want to thank you for, Lord, clothing us in our right mind. We want to thank you for the activity of our limbs. We want to thank you, Lord, that we can get up and we can go and we can put on our own clothes and we can brush our teeth. That we want to thank you, Lord, for things that people take for granted so often. We thank you that we don't have to worry about the basic necessities of life. We thank you that we don't have to be consumed with our cares and our concerns, but we can trust in you with all of our hearts. We can commit our ways unto you, knowing, God, that you shall establish our goings forth. We thank you today, for this is the day that you've made, and we're going to continue to rejoice in it in spite of what it looks like, in spite of what we hear, in spite of how we feel at times. We know, oh God, that our praise should always be predicated on who you are as God and for what you have done for us through Christ and for what you will do for us, Lord, in the future. We've come today, Lord, to let it be known, Lord, that there's no one like our God. We pray that you would forgive us of our sins. Surely we have gone astray. Surely we've fallen short of the goodness and glory of Almighty, Father. But we thank you that your word says if we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord, we thank you that you're able to create in us clean hearts and renew in us steadfast, right spirits. And so our prayer is like the psalmist, search us, O God, and know us. And if there's anything within us that's not like you, if there's anything in us that's unlike the character of Jesus Christ, we know that you're able, Lord, to remove those things from us. We know that you're able to circumcise our hearts and regulate our minds and Lord, touch us where we are. We thank you right now that we are becoming more and more like the Lord Jesus Christ in his character and in his conduct and in his will. We thank you right now, Lord, for what the church is still accomplishing in these troubling times and in these difficult days. We want to thank you for how you're using churches all across this land, all across this world, how you're using the church, Lord, to keep lifted the bloodstained banner of the Lord Jesus Christ. We want to praise you for how you've, Lord, used us in times like these, Lord, to continue to share and spread the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we ask, oh God, that you would continue to use us in your service so that men, women, boys, and girls would be exposed to the reality that there is a true and living God who is worthy to be served and who's worthy to be worshiped. Oh, Father, we lift up this world to you right now. We lift up these United States of America. Lord, we're living in some difficult times, some perilous times. There's so much disunity and discord in the land, but we know, Lord, that you're able. We know that unity and solidarity can come among us if we all just come together and realize that we've all been made in the image and likeness of God. We're praying for our leaders that they would, Lord, come together and that they would, Lord, reach across the aisle and look for ways on how they can set an example, Lord, to every American citizen. Oh, Lord, have mercy. We're praying for leaders in high places all across this globe who have to lead their people, Lord, through these troubling times, our Lord, our doctors and our physicians, Lord, our medical staff, our professional workers, they need strength, they need protection, they need wisdom and knowledge, Lord, on how to develop cures for those who have been afflicted with this coronavirus. We know that there's nothing too hard for you to do. We know, Lord, that if you was able to give us a cure for other diseases and other, Lord, sicknesses, you're still able and you still have all power in your hand. And so, Father, we're crying out unto you because all of our help comes from you. We're lifting up those who are on the front lines, Lord, our doctors and nurses, all of those who have to serve in hospitals and serve in grocery stores, who are driving trucks, who are daily exposing themselves to these elements. We're praying for their protection in the name of Jesus Christ. And Father, we're praying that our leaders would look to you for wisdom, for knowledge and understanding on how, Lord, to navigate through these times of adversity. Oh God, we're going to be so very careful to give your name all glory, honor, and praise. For we know, oh God, regardless of what man says, we're going to wait on the Lord. We're going to be of good courage, for we know that you shall strengthen our hearts. We're going to wait on you, oh Lord. Lord, we're going to wait on you, and we thank you now for this opportunity to worship you in spirit and in truth. Touch every person who is listening, Lord, via Facebook Live and conference call. Lord, let this worship experience enhance their walk with you. Let this worship experience draw them closer and closer to you. For we realize that although we're practicing social distancing from one another, from each other, we know, God, that we can't become, Lord, separated from you. We know that we need to draw closer and closer to you. For we realize that when we're in your presence, there is fullness of joy. We thank you now. It's in Jesus' name that we pray, amen and amen. We thank God for the privilege. We thank God for the responsibility, the right to praise him, and for the privilege to pray unto him, to pray according to the will of God. We pray that this prayer, praise, and preaching video for April, this third Sunday in the month of April, is finding you in good health and perfect peace. Our prayer is that all is well with you. And of course, we know that these are troubling times and difficult days for everyone. For everyone is being affected in some kind of way by the challenges that we face as a world. Yet, in spite of that, we know that our God is still good and our God is still great. And so we are praying for all of those who are listening and all of those who are still tuning in to Stronghold Baptist Church via Facebook Live and conference call. Before we get into the Word of God, we want to encourage every member to continue to support the local church, your local church. Continue to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness through our financial contributions. We know that God loves a cheerful giver. And it's times like these where we have to continue to press forward and move forward with the will of God for our lives. And so we want to encourage you to continue to give obediently, give proportionately, continue to give cheerfully. Now is not the time to suspend our commitment to God. I wonder if someone would say amen in Facebook land and on conference call. This is not the time to lask and to get behind in our overall commitment for the Lord. These times does not serve and should not serve as a break for Christians. We're not on break. We're not on spring break. We're not on summer break. We're still serving the Lord. Amen. We're still serving the Lord. We're still worshiping the Lord. We're still talking to the Lord. We are still doing for the Lord what he has gifted us to do. And our financial stewardship is just one of the many aspects of our commitment to God. And so I want to encourage you as pastor to keep on keeping on. Amen. Keep on keeping on. Don't become lax in that area. And so please, many of you still want to come and drop it off to our physical location, 2401 South Galvez Street, New Orleans, Louisiana, 70125. Yes, come on and do that. Keep on doing that. Amen. And for those of you who want to drop it off to our P.O. Box, 13654, New Orleans, Louisiana, 70185. Yes, keep on doing that. Whatever is convenient for you. We have made giving easier. It's not just a physical location, but we've also made it convenient for those who want to just send it electronically through their phones. And so we want to encourage you to, if you want to take advantage of that, we want to encourage you to download the Givelify app on your phone, and you can set up your payment. You can set up your credit card, debit card, and you can just give with the click of a button on a very secure and safe phone app. And so I encourage you to use that as well. And we've also added a cash app as well. So we have a number of options for the people of God to give back unto the Lord. Amen. I just hope and pray that you didn't turn me off mentally as I was talking about giving. Giving is important. As a matter of fact, Paul tells us that giving is a part of worship. This is how we worship God. Our worship, our giving is like a sweet aroma in the nostrils of God. And so let me pose that question to you. What has God been smelling lately since these pandemic times? So what has God been smelling from your offering? I hope and pray that it has been a sweet aroma in the nostrils of God, essentially saying, I hope it's been pleasing in the eyes of God. And so we want to continue to please him, especially in the area of our giving. Amen. But we can say more about that. That's a whole nother sermon that's coming. But I want to get into the word of God. There's a word from heaven. I really want us to turn to the book of Philippians. Turn with me to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. And I want us to look at verse 12 through 14. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. Guide me, O thou land.
Almighty, hold me with thy powerful hand.
From the New King James Version. But I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel, so that it has become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ. And most of the brethren in the Lord, having become confident by my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. I want to also read this from the English Standard Version. I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God will always stand. With the time that is ours to share, I want us to look at this text, and with this text in mind, I want to preach from this title, Encouragement from Paul's Circumstances. Encouragement from Paul's circumstances. Maybe you can help me say that by saying encouragement from Paul's circumstances. Nothing can seem more upending and upsetting than the sovereignty of God colliding with your current situations. I have often heard that God can do whatever he wants to do, whenever he wants to do it, and to whomever he wants to do it. And he never has to provide an explanation for why he is doing what he's doing. As believers, we know something about the sovereignty of God. As believers, we know something, in fact, about the unlimited scope of the sovereignty of God. We don't always understand it, but we know that he is sovereign. We know that God is always at work. We know that he is always working behind the scenes. We know that if he never takes his eye off the smallest sparrow, then he never takes his eyes off us. We know that he always keeps his divine foot, if you will, on the accelerator pad of life. He still keeps earth spinning on an axis. He still keeps the rivers and the streams and the oceans with enough water and with enough food. He still keeps the mountains high enough and the valleys low enough. He still keeps the sun with enough energy, with enough heat to heat our planet. We know that God is still at work. He's working. We know that he is willing, he is doing, he is governing, he is presiding, he is causing, he is allowing, he is bringing to pass. Our God is very much involved. Our God is not some aloof, indifferent, unconcerned deity who just created the heavens and the earth and went into the corner never again to be involved with his creation. Our God is personal. He knows us by name. He knows the number of hairs on our head. He knows the words that we're going to say before we can even speak them. He knows, David said, our rising and our falling, our going in and our coming out. He's very much involved. And while we cannot always pinpoint why he does what he does, and why we cannot always pinpoint why he allows certain things to happen at the end of the day. Beloved, when you lay your head on the pillow, you can say that we know that he's sovereign. The world's current situation of the coronavirus global pandemic is revealing what really matters to people. Our current situation, this coronavirus pandemic, is showing what is really in our hearts and what is really on our minds. This current situation, people of God, is putting on display our true occupations, our true preoccupations, and our true priorities. You know, there is nothing like a good old crisis to reveal our commitments and our convictions. And I think we would do well today, like the Philippian believers, to take a few cues from how the Apostle Paul looked at every situation. In this prison letter, the book of Philippians, Paul continues to follow the standard style of ancient letter writing. Paul continues to follow that ancient style of letter writing by beginning this letter with a greeting and then a thanksgiving and prayer section, and then he gives them an update on his current situation. Yes, he greets them. He thanks God for them, thanks God for them in particular, for the partnership that has been established between the Philippian church and the Apostle Paul. He's thanking God for their partnership in the gospel. And then he expresses in that same opening section his confidence that God, who began a good work in them, will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. And then still in just that small opening section, he begins to pray unto God for them that their love and their knowledge would abound, that it would grow, that it would never stop growing. And he prays that they would be filled with the fruits of righteousness. Paul is greeting them by thanking them and praying for them and expressing his confidence that God ain't finished with them yet. This same God who saved them will bring to pass the good work that he started in them. And after Paul finishes praying for these Philippian believers, he then provides them the report about himself that they've all been waiting to hear. In fact, this update or this report from the Apostle Paul is one of the primary purposes for Paul writing this letter to the Philippian Christians. And listen, people of God, the Philippian church deserved an update on Paul's welfare. There was this patron-client relationship between Paul and the Philippian church. They had invested in Paul's ministry and they were very concerned about his welfare. The very fact that the church in Philippi had dispatched their fellow brother Epaphroditus to bring to Paul a gift of goods and money indicates for us that this church invested financially in the ministry and the apostleship of the Apostle Paul. And so there was this, if you will, this patron-client relationship. And they deserve to hear about Paul's welfare. That they needed an update. They were in the need of a report about Paul's whereabouts and Paul's well-being. And they had invested so much in his ministry. And so Paul's response to the Philippian Christians is not uncharacteristic for the Apostle Paul. It's not uncharacteristic for those who are in a patron-client relationship. It's not uncharacteristic for someone giving someone else a report about how things were going for them. But as Paul shares this report, as Paul provides them with an update, he also sheds light on his perspective. Let me say that one more time so you can get it. As Paul shares the report, as Paul shares with them the update on how it's going for him, he also, in the process, sheds light on his perspective. What could have been? What could have been a gloomy, hopeless, down in the dumps kind of report? What could have been a troubling, discouraging update is, beloved, actually a triumphant testimony about what the Lord is doing in the life of the Apostle Paul. Well, if you haven't caught it by now, let me just go ahead and help you. Paul is actually testifying to the greatness and the goodness of God despite his current situation. If Paul had Facebook, if Paul had Instagram, if Paul had Twitter, maybe he would take a picture of his chains in Christ, his literal shackles, his literal chains in Christ, and put a hashtag, my current situation, but then put some praise hands on the end of it, because in the midst of his chains in Christ, in the midst of his Roman imprisonment, the Apostle Paul had a perspective that indicated for the Philippian Christians that I'm testifying to the greatness and goodness of God despite my current situations. I will not be gloomy. I will not be hopeless. I will not act like I'm helpless. I will not live down in the dumps. This is a positive, triumphant testimony about what the Lord is doing. And if I had some people who knew the book of Psalms, you would tell me, if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, let all Israel say, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I don't know where I would be. For the Apostle Paul, beloved, what could have been a very discouraging report for these Philippian Christians who were obviously struggling with persecution themselves. Just keep reading the book of Philippians, you will discover that they had their own share of struggles with respect to persecution. And they were struggling with this. And what could have been for them discouraging news from the Apostle Paul, who himself was dealing with persecution, has actually become encouraging news. Not discouraging news, but encouraging news. And can I just submit to you today that we can be encouraged by Paul's circumstances, because Paul displayed a Christ-centered perspective. There it is. There's your first point for the sermon. If you want to be encouraged from Paul's circumstances, then you have to develop a Christ-centered perspective. You have to develop, beloved, and maintain a mindset, an attitude, a perspective that is rooted and grounded
in the person and the work of Jesus Christ. This is not some I'm going to just be positive kind of a faith, optimistic kind of a faith. Your faith has to be attached and cemented into who Jesus Christ is and what Jesus Christ has already done. You need a perspective. And look at what Paul says to indicate to us his Christ-centered perspective. He says, but I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me have actually turned out for the, let me stop right there because I don't want to get too ahead of myself, but do notice that sentence in that first verse that we're in, verse 12, it indicates to us the perspective of Paul. Paul did not develop a woe is me mentality. He did not whine and complain about how he ended up a prisoner in the city of Rome. He did not air his grievances. He did not give them a long laundry list of things that dissatisfied him and things that caused him to be discouraged. My brothers and sisters, Paul possessed a Christ-centered perspective. Paul possessed a God consciousness that motivated him to dig up from under the dirt reasons to give God glory for his imprisonment. And I think you ought to take a few cues from Paul with respect to knowing how and learning how to dig up from the dirt reasons to give God glory for whatever is going on in your life. The Apostle Paul was like David in Psalm 16, verse 8 through 9, when David says, I have set the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. I will not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoices. My flesh also will rest and hope. Paul was like David. He had set the Lord always before him, and because the Lord was at his right hand, Paul was not going to be moved in his faith by this Roman imprisonment. Paul was not going to curtail his convictions. Paul was not going to budge in his beliefs. Paul was unmovable, steadfast, always, beloved, abounding in the work of the Lord. You know, Paul had that Romans 8 and 28 mentality. He didn't just write it so that he could fill up the page. He didn't just write it so he could just tell us what to do, but Paul put it into practice as well when he said, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are the called according to his purpose. Paul is basically saying, listen, I want you to know this one thing about me, that I know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are the called according to his purpose. Brothers and sisters, Paul is saying this to the Philippian Christians. I want you to get this about me. I really desire for you to know this particular thing and never forget this one thing about me. I know you've heard some stuff. I know you've heard some things about my whereabouts and my welfare, my well-being, but I want you to put this into your mind and never forget it, in spite of how intense persecution may become, in spite of what you hear. I want you to remember this thing about me, because this is what really matters. This is what really matters for me. This is what Paul is saying to them in that 12th verse. If I wanted to, I could go on and on about the things that can potentially trouble me. If I wanted to, I could go on and on about the vicissitudes of life. And if I wanted to, I could give you a long list of my perils and my problems. If I wanted to, I could give you a long list about my injuries and my injustice. If I wanted to, I could give you a long list about my mistreatment and misunderstandings. But our God is so great. Our God is so good that he turns it around for his good. I want you to remember, Philippians, how it all turned out for the furtherance of the gospel. I want you to remember and never forget how it really served to advance the gospel. I wish I had some Psalm 34 people in Facebook Live land and on the conference call land who can say, yeah, I could go on and on about my problems. I could go on and on about my perils. I could go on and on about my injuries and my injustice. I could go on and on about this and that, but God is so good and God is so great. I'll take a page out of David's book when he said, oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. I will not magnify my problems. I will not magnify my perils. I will not magnify my injuries and my injustice. But one thing that I'll magnify is the greatness and the goodness of our God. Oh, my brothers and sisters, if you and I will just keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, if you and I will just keep looking beyond the hills, knowing that our help comes from the Lord, the maker and creator of the heavens and earth, if you and I will just allow the reality of God's greatness and goodness to stimulate us to serve him no matter what comes our way. If you and I would just keep building our hopes on things eternal, if you and I would just keep holding on to God's unchanging hands, then we could praise God in the midst of a global pandemic. Then we can maintain the joy of the Lord when the global thermometer reads awful and horrible. Then we could experience the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, while we're passing through the valley of the shadow of death. Then we can still be committed to Christ when things are not comfortable and when things are not convenient. Then we can know how to see every circumstance as an opportunity. Then we can see every disappointment as an appointment by God. Then we can see every trial as a testimony. Then we can see every vicissitude of life as a vehicle. Then we can see every piece of dirt as saw to make us grow. Then we can see a silver lining behind every cloud. Then we can see a light at the end of every tunnel. If you can just keep a God-centered, Christ-centered perspective, then you can be like David and say, I'll bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. That's Paul's perspective. My brothers and sisters, if you're going to be encouraged by Paul's circumstances, in the midst of your circumstances, that number one, you've got to have that perspective. You've got to have a Christ-centered perspective. But then secondly, notice progress. Notice what Paul says, still in that verse, and then going into the next verse, for the furtherance of the gospel. For the greater progress, one translation says, of the gospel. Then another translation says that it has helped spread the gospel. Mm-hmm. Beloved, I want you to know, Paul says, the things which have happened to me have actually turned out to spread the gospel. The things which have actually, the things which have happened to me have actually advanced the gospel. The gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ has made significant progress because of the things which have happened unto me. If you know anything about Paul, then you know that he was not a selfish Christian. If you know anything about Paul, you will agree with me that he was not a self-serving Christian. He was not in the ministry to serve himself. He did nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit. He esteemed others, in fact, better than he did himself. And because he was a servant of Christ, Paul saw his situations useful. I want you to get that, beloved. Because he was a servant of Christ, Paul saw his situations useful to accomplish the mission of God. He saw his situations and his circumstances as beneficial for the advancement of the gospel. That word, that Greek word for furtherance or advance, was used of blazing a trail before an army. It was a military word, in fact, to move forward. And this is not just some mere ability to move forward or go forward, but this was moving forward against opposition. This was moving forward against resistance. This was the kind of moving forward that was against distractions and dangers. And Paul says that my imprisonment and all of the things that have happened to me leading up to my imprisonment have actually turned out for the advancement or the furtherance of the gospel. A trail has been blazed because of my change in Christ. And the gospel is moving forward. The gospel is moving forward in spite of the opposition and the obstacles, in spite of my opponents. The gospel is moving forward in spite of the resistance from the Roman Empire. The gospel is moving forward in spite of distractions and danger. Paul's chains, my brothers and sisters, advance the gospel of Jesus Christ. But let me just purposely pause here and ask now, can the church of the living God just survey this whole situation concerning the coronavirus pandemic? Can the church just pause for a moment and show the world what we have reasons to give God glory for? Can the world just pause and praise our God in the midst of a pandemic and let the world see the good works that are within us? For the Lord Jesus said, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. I want to tell you, there's a correlation between what you say about God and what you do for God, and unbelievers drawing near to God. Someone needs to hear what you got to say about God. Someone needs to see what you're gifted to do for God. And when they hear it, and when they see it, and when they experience, don't you know that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few? Can the church just pause and just say to the world, we've got something to shout about. We've got something to celebrate. the church to pause and survey this whole situation. That we've got leaders for that. We have economists for that. We have physicians for that. Why do you want us to get into this kind of situation and survey the situation? Well, because we have enough people, y'all. We have enough people upset about this coronavirus pandemic. We have enough people upset, yeah, that they haven't received their stimulus checks. We have enough people upset that they gotta wait on their stimulus check to come in the mail and then gotta see the president's signature in the memo section. We've got enough people upset that they gotta continue working from home with those bad, you know what, children running around the hallway and jumping on the bed, and you're trying to submit a report by 4 o'clock in the afternoon and it's already 3:59. We've got enough people upset that the children are out of school until next year. No, not May, but until the next school year. We've got enough people upset that there's no spring break, there's no summer break. We've got to continue practicing social distancing. There's enough people upset that they can't do their crawfish balls, they can't go to their concerts, they can't go to the Saints game, because Mayor Cantrell says we've got to resist and we've got to refuse all of these large gatherings. The Walmart line is ridiculously long. The Sam's line is ridiculously long. There's no hand sanitizer, no Clorox. Man can't buy a roll of toilet paper because everybody wants all the toilet paper. But just go ahead, church, and display a divine perspective that will captivate a dying world by telling them about the goodness and the greatness of our God. Can you just go ahead? Can you just go ahead and just become your own praise and worship leader? I know you miss being in church. I know you're church sick. I know you wish you were sitting in your favorite seat. I know you wish you were sitting on your favorite pew. I know you wish you could still hug the saints of God every Sunday morning. I know you wish you could be in the presence of God in the local church's sanctuary. I know you wish you could witness to the pastor and say amen to the pastor when he starts preaching real good. I know you wish you could be in the midst of when praises go up in the church, the blessings come down. But listen here, just go ahead wherever you are and become your own praise and worship leader and do a little ad-libbing on the greatness and goodness of God and thank God that he woke you up this morning. Thank God that he clothed you in the right mind. Thank God that he kept food on your table. Thank God that he kept clothes on your back. Thank God that he's got a roof over your head. If it had not been for the Lord, it was on my side, where would I be? Just go ahead and thank God where you are. And just be your own praise and worship leader. And just praise and worship him for his greatness and his goodness. Can we thank God like Paul? Can we praise God like Paul? Can we thank God like Paul that the gospel can still be advanced amid adversity when we announce the good news? I'll say it again. Can we thank God like Paul that the gospel can still be advanced amid adversity when we announce the good news? Can the church thank God for how God is using us to spread the gospel? Well, we're not in the business of spreading the virus. We're trying to spread the gospel. And can the church of the living God thank him for how he's using the church all across this world to spread the gospel, to advance the gospel amid adversity by just announcing the good news. Can you thank God that churches all over this world have Facebook accounts and they're going Facebook Live for every Sunday worship and Facebook Live for their midweek worship and Facebook Live and conference call for their prayer, intercessory prayer and midweek prayer. Can you thank God for how the church is finding creative, unique ways to get the message out that yes, Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and salvation comes through Him and Him alone. Can you thank God that even in a pandemic, we are still advancing, we are still announcing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ? I told you that the Apostle Paul has a perspective. Then the Apostle Paul notes the progress of the gospel. My brothers and sisters, I got to leave you, but notice that the progress that Paul is focusing on has really nothing to do with his physical condition. It really has nothing to do with his personal sufferings and troubles. Paul has not focused or is not focusing he's not focusing progress from God's standpoint on how comfortable and how convenient he is. Paul's understanding of progress has to do with the advancement of the gospel. That sounds ironic to a world who scratches their head at churches of the living God, who can still declare progress. And their churches have been empty since last month. The world scratches their head at how the church can say that they're making progress when they can't even assemble on Sundays and during the midweek. When they can't continue to do the things that they've been accustomed to doing for thousands of years. But the progress has to do not from our sense of convenience, but it has to do with the advancement of the gospel. And we can say progress because God's gospel is getting out. Mm-hmm. But then finally, number three, and I'll leave you alone. Notice proclamation. Perspective, progress, proclamation. Notice the proclamation of the gospel. Verses 13 through 14, Paul says, so that it has become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ, and most of the brethren in the Lord, having become confident by my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. You know, Paul was a believer who was ready to preach the gospel. He was a believer who was ready to, in the Greek, euangelizo, I'm ready to preach the gospel. He was a believer who was not ashamed of the gospel, the Greek word, the euangelion. He was not ashamed of that, for he says in Romans 1 and 16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation for the Jew and then for the Greek. He was not ashamed of that. And in verses 13 through 14, here's what Paul is rejoicing about. He's rejoicing about, number one, that people are hearing the gospel. He's rejoicing over the fact that these unbelievers in Rome are hearing the gospel through his chains in Christ. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. He's rejoicing Because although he is in captivity and held captive by literal chains, he has a captivated, he's captivated audiences. This audience of these Roman soldiers, these elite Roman soldiers that make up the Roman palace guard, thousands upon thousands of Roman soldiers, Paul says they are hearing the gospel message, and I believe that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. If they're going to have faith in Jesus, then they first have to hear the word about Jesus. Then Paul is rejoicing because people are sharing the gospel. Paul is not only talking about how his chains have impacted unbelievers, but Paul is also rejoicing over the reality that his chains have impacted believers. Let me say it again. Paul is rejoicing in the reality that his chains have not only impacted unbelievers, these Roman soldiers in that make up the Roman palace guard, and who have spread the word to all of the rest of the people within the vicinity, but he's also rejoicing that people are sharing the gospel. Believers are sharing the gospel. My brothers and sisters, we've got to have courage to share the gospel message. Look at what Paul says in that last phrase of verse 14. They are much more bold to speak the word without fear. That word for boldness, it means to show courage, to confront fear in the face of danger and anxiety and uncertainty. It is the ability to confront all of that fear and all of that danger and uncertainty, to be bold in the midst of fear and opposition. We've got to have that Joseph of Arimathea kind of courage, that Joseph of Arimathea kind of boldness, when in Mark 15 and verse 43, after the Lord has died, the Bible says that Joseph of Arimathea, who was himself waiting for the kingdom of God, he gathered up courage, or he took courage, and he went in before Pilate, and he asked for the bloody, bruised, and dead body of Jesus the Christ, not knowing what could have happened to him, for asking for the body. But he mustered up enough courage in the face of fear and danger and opposition and Roman resistance, and he took the body down in front of all of those who were viewing the crucifixion and death of Jesus, and he still had enough courage to take that body and then lay it in his own personal tomb. And you know what happened when Joseph laid the body of Jesus in his own tomb. The body stayed there Friday night and all day Saturday and Saturday night, but early Sunday morning, Jesus got up with power in his hand. I'm coming to tell you today that if you can have that kind of Joseph of Arimathea courage and boldness to advance the gospel, to do something for the Lord in the face of adversity, in the face of the adversaries, in the face of danger and difficulty, notice and be mindful of the glory of God that shall be revealed. My brothers and sisters, all I've come to tell you today is we can have encouragement from Paul's circumstances. You too, you and I, as Christians, are going to experience situations and circumstances that will not be comfortable and convenient. But like the Apostle Paul, if we can have a Christ-centered perspective, if we can know what true progress really means from God's point of view, and if you and I can proclaim
the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, no matter what, God will get all of the glory. To God be the glory. We pray and hope that something has been said on today, this third Sunday of the month of April, that has inspired you to move forward with the will and word of God in spite of what you experience. We pray that you have experienced encouragement to keep holding on to God's unchanging hands. My brothers and sisters, we can pause today, and unlike the world, we can give God glory. Unlike the world, we can praise God for who He is. We can praise God. Many of us can praise God for the simple fact that we're still here. We can praise God for the simple fact that we've been going into these grocery stores. We've been wearing our gloves. We've been wearing our face masks. And sometimes we can still contact germs. And don't know what kind of germ we're contacting, we've been in contact with. But God has been keeping us. We can rejoice today over the fact that we know people who have been down because of this coronavirus. But God healed them. We have people in our church who were down, but God healed them.
Yes, yes.
We have people right now in their bed of affliction, but we know God is with them. For He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. So we can be like Paul, and we can look for that silver lining, and we can look for the light at the end of the tunnel with that divine perspective. My brothers and sisters, many of us can praise God over the fact that we're $1,200 richer. Some of us, we've not experienced any pay cut. Some of us, we haven't lost our job. Some of us, we're not in that unemployment line. We've experienced no alteration or change to our fixed income. We still making the same amount of money we've been making, and yet we get to benefit from a stimulus package, and we've got more money today than we had a couple of months ago because of it. And we can thank God for that. We have so many things to praise God for. Let us continue to wait on the Lord. Let us continue to pray and praise the Lord while we go through. And I pray and hope that something has been said on today that has helped you in that endeavor of praising and worshiping the Lord. Thank you again for all of you who are listening and been tuned in to our prayer, praise, and preaching on Facebook Live and to our conference call. We pray and we hope that you'll continue to enjoy and be blessed during the rest of your day, and that God will bless this new week for you. Let us look to God, our help and our strength. Now unto Him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy, to Thee, only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen and amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.